Hi guys, and welcome to a very, very special double interview here on the Books on Toast channel. You guys are in for a special treat because we've got the stalwarts of Indian storytelling right here on the set with us. We've got Deepa Mehta and Vivek Shanbhag, all thanks to the fantastic JCB Prize for Literature. I'm Sharin.
And I am Anuya. And what is the JCB Prize for Literature? The JCB Prize for Literature is an award, now in its first year, designed to identify and recognize great Indian contemporary writing. And the best part is that the winner gets 25 lakhs.
Yeah, that's a lot. The format is really simple. Earlier this week, they announced 10 books that made it to the long list. By the end of this month, or by October 3rd, they'll announce 5 books that will have made it to the shortlist. And at the end of it all, there'll be one grand winner.
But before we go into the details, let's introduce the guests that we have with us today. I mean, I can't even believe they've allowed us to sit here.
Yeah.
Like, how did this happen? Someone pinch me. I just want to say I'm really sorry about what's going to happen now, guys. There are going to be some really awful jokes and it's going to be my fault. So apologies in advance, but thank you for coming.
Yay! Yeah, and the children are very happy. But introducing our guests quickly, we have the celebrated and award-winning Indo-Canadian filmmaker Deepa Mehta, who's given us some amazing movies like Earth, Fire and Midnight's Children. Her list of accomplishments are long and amazing.
And then we have Mr. Vivek Shanbhag with us. You've heard of him on this channel. We love his book, Ghachar Gochar, but he's also written 7 other novels, is that correct? And 2 plays, yeah, in Kannada. And I mean, I can't even, this is like getting to discuss the end of Inception with Christopher Nolan. Because I'm going to quiz him about the end of Ghachar Gochar after this, because I need to know if what I think happened actually happened. Welcome to Books on Toast, guys. Thank
pleasure.
You.
Thank
you.
Pleasure being pleasure. Here. Thank you.
So let's start with the questions, shall we? And let our guests do all the talking now.
Oh, Deepa. Is that possible?
We will try. So Deepa, why don't we start with you. How did you guys get involved with the JCB Prize?
I'll speak for myself. I was asked by Rana Das Gupta, who is the what I call the great leader, and if I would consider it, and he told me what the prize was for the JCB Prize and what the intent of the prize was, a celebration of contemporary Indian writing that involved not just writers in English but actually went on to the vernacular, which was extremely attractive, as well as what he said to me was I think that the fact that the prize was transparent and very closely monitor, and B, that it would have the books themselves, the long list, the short list, and the winner, all would have real exposure to India and to the world. I guess that's why we're here, right?
Okay. And Vivek?
Yeah, I got into this because it's literature and reading Indian writing. I was a little hesitant because while I read a lot, I'm a voracious reader, but this is something like reading for exams because you have no choice but to read these books. So this was something that I wasn't very convinced, but then Rana persuaded me and then I agreed to it.
Reading for exams, yes. There's no choice, yeah.
I mean, today I feel so relieved.
Do you have dreams about this day where you're like unprepared and...
Not really. I think we really were more than prepared, more than required, I think.
Ask him about that. Because it's that's interesting.
Because,
yeah.
Because it is, some of the books we probably had not appreciated much. When other jury members pointed those things out, we reread them. I might have reread some books and others might have. You know, I made similar suggestions. So it's not that we have read these books once.
Oh, you
some of the books we have read more than once. So that's how it was.
So you were the chair of the jury, right, Deepa? So can you, for the viewers, explain this process of identification and selection of the books and how you eventually pulled out the 10 books that have made it to the long list and who had what role to play?
I think, you know, looking back, it was a highly democratic process. Rana and Alfred from JCB were the ones who facilitated us, made sure that, you know, the books came in on time from the publishers, went through Ernst and Young, just, you know, logical way that they arrived at us. And I think that, Vivek, wasn't it that piece I said, I took it very seriously. I think they were getting really quite bored with me. I said, okay, now we have to finish reading 8 books by 3 weeks. And there was dead silence. Yeah, I took it too seriously, obviously. But it was really good because, in a way, they told me to shut up. And but no, seriously, they were just, we realized that this had to be taken very seriously. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I think that is what helped us. Like, discipline is very important if you have to, like Vivek says, go for an exam. And it was that focus, inspiring that focus, or demanding it, not inspiring it, but demanding it to a certain degree, and getting everybody. And everybody was really into that, mm-hmm. into wanting to do it. They took it seriously. They committed to it. They wanted to do their best.
How many books did you guys come down from?
60, I think.
Wow. 60 plus.
60 plus. Maybe.
Did you finish reading it in like a month?
No.
3 months.
3 months. Not a month would have been
basically
heroic.
Basically, this was the most intense and the most acclaimed book club anyone can ever be a part of, right?
Really, yeah. Like a really serious book club.
Yeah. Very committed book club.
So let me quickly, to our viewers, tell who these esteemed people were in this really cool book club, which is the jury. So there was, of course, Deepa Mehta, who was the chair, and entrepreneur and scholar Rohan Murthy, Yale University astrophysicist and writer Priyamvada Natarajan, novelist Vivek Shanbhag, and of course, author and translator Arshia Sattar. Did you guys come to blows?
Well, luckily, we were all in different time zones. No, I'm just kidding. No, but, you know, that's what happens in juries. Film juries are not very different. This is my first time on a literary jury.
Okay.
And film juries are not that different. You know, you have, that's the idea about having a dialogue. You have different points of view. People come from diverse backgrounds. They have different values, different cultural takes on things.
Yeah.
And but the main thing is that can we get over our personal prejudices or observations and make it just about the books? And that's what happened, I think, that it became about the books.
Should I quickly recap the 10 books?
Yes.
That have been longlisted. So this is my take. It's All the Lives We Never Lived by Anuradha Roy, who I'm sure has been called Arundhati Roy multiple times in her life. My suggestion to her is that she should get a stage name like Madonna. Jasoda by Kiran Nagarkar. Obviously, there's a book here by Kiran Nagarkar, because otherwise it would have been like the Best Picture nominations without a Steven Spielberg movie.
Mm-hmm.
So, Kiran Nagarkar, Steven Spielberg movie. Okay, thanks. Latitudes of Longing by Shubhangi Swarup. Incidentally, we just interviewed her. Complete
this
coincidence.
Morning. Complete coincidence.
Yeah.
Yes. Really loved her book.
Then there was Half the Night is Gone by Amitabh Bakshi. And that is also what we felt when we were preparing for this interview. Half the night was gone and we were not ready. That's not true. We started working on it 2 months ago. That's not true. Yes. Jasmine Days by Benjamin. Empire by Devi Yasodharan. Punachi by Perumal Murugan, which is a book that we discussed in our Translated Indian Literature episode. Book of Chocolate Saints by Jeet Tail. Do not read that if you're on diet. Clouds by Chandrahas Chaudhary. Proving once again that alliteration is here to stay. And then there is When the Moon Shines by Day by Nayantara Sehgal, also known as Eclipse, but that title was taken by Stephanie Meyer. Thank you. Is there any point in asking if you guys have any favorites?
I don't think that would be politically correct.
Oh.
You can ask Vivek.
Vivek!
I have all 10 are my favorites.
Ye sare bache mere
kya hai? Ek
Deepa, if you were to adapt one of them,
all of them.
Oh, guys, we are trying so hard. Okay, I guess this is also a good time to introduce the reading challenge. Mm-hmm. So we are going to do a condensed version of what you guys did.
Mm-hmm.
And we are going to announce a reading challenge for all our viewers and our readers, loyal, passionate readers who are watching the show. What you have to do is you have to read 10 of the books mentioned in the long list, and we will be listing them in the description again so you know what they are before the shortlist is announced. So you have till October 3rd to finish reading all 10 books. What you can do is you can update after you've read each book and share a review on Twitter and on Instagram using hashtag JCB Reading Challenge. And also, before the shortlist is announced, share your prediction of who will make it to the shortlist. One lucky winner whose answer comes closest to the actual shortlist gets to come to Delhi for the finale. You can come there and watch the winner get crowned with all of us.
Yes, they'll be in reverse order, like the Miss World pageant. In second, runner-up, no.
We are going to edit this part out.
I don't think you should. It's really nice.
Let's listen to the director.
Yeah, listen to the director.
If you guys need help with reading tips, you can also pair up with a buddy like we are going to do.
Yeah, we're going to do this together.
I have a head start because I've already read 2 books
I don't
on
like,
this list.
I've read 1.
Yeah.
But I'm going to beat her. I'm going to beat her.
Let's see. Deepa, do you have any reading tips for us so that we can finish reading this?
And so I'll read all 10 of them.
At the same time?
At the same time.
That's actually a great tip.
Great tip, it is.
I think the clouds will get confused with some other thing.
Yeah, we'll just be like, yes, Arundhati Roy is part of this shortlist.
Are all your shows like this?
Yes. Yes, they are. One thing that we always try to do whenever we shoot an episode of Books on Toast is leave our readers with as many reading recommendations as possible. Mm-hmm. So in order to get that, because both of you are such voracious readers yourself, what are your reading habits like? What was the last book that you read that you really, really loved, that left an impact, apart from, of course, the books in mm-hmm. the long list?
The one that really left an impact on me, which I finished when we finished doing the long list, was rereading Giovanni's Room by James Baldwin. Mm. And I just felt that it was time to read it again. Mm-hmm. And it didn't disappoint me at all. It felt that's what we were talking about when we were talking about the books, was that how relevant are these books going to be? And they should be years later. Mm. And you pick up Giovanni's Room and it's as relevant today, as in fact more relevant today than it ever was. So that was very interesting to read.
Right.
Yeah. Of course, I have read so much for this award that it is... I do go back to the books which I have read, and it is always, you know, pleasure to go back to the books. The one that I read recently, or you know, as recent as yesterday, was Isaac Bashevis Singer's In My Father's Court.
Oh, yes.
And it is, though it's written, you know, decades ago, but the books are, you know, they are all, every book is contemporary. I mean, Shakespeare is contemporary today. It's not that, you know, it's not like... It's pleasure reading these writers and going back to them again and again. And that's why, you know, it's important that when we talk about books, when we select books, it's important to make those recommendations, which at least we think last long.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how do you think something like the JCB Prize for Literature, what do you think it's going to do for this Indian literary scene? Like, what is the eventual goal?
See, it must encourage a discussion about books. That's the whole purpose of the prize. Right. It's not a lot about, you know, which book wins the prize. Obviously, one book will win the prize. But that's not the point. The point is that, you know, for example, the long list that we have, we just announced, it is like a group of friends telling you to, you know, recommending these books to you.
That's
look,
true.
These are the books that have been, you know, we have gone through, you know, 60 odd books, and we have read and discussed, and out of that, we have picked up these 10 books for you to read. Mm-hmm. So that is our recommendation. It is like, you know, a friend recommends books to you.
Yeah.
And I always go by recommendation of various people because they come from different backgrounds and their choice is different, their taste is different. So you must treat this list of 10 books as that. And from here on, I feel that those 10 books must generate a lot of discussion around these books. Mm. like just now what you said, you know, there's a book challenge of people reading and you know, guessing, you know, those five books are there, because it is not just, you know, guessing. Guessing, of course, there's an intelligent guess. And the intelligence requires one to read the books, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So it is all these things, things matter a lot. And then you talk about these books. And so that is, if we can generate that interest, then I think it will make a difference to the reading habits of the people and so on.
True. And even access, like you're saying, right?
Yeah.
Like a lot of us also only pick up books that are recommended by peers. And hence, you know, that sort of adds validation to the fact that, okay, you are this kind of person, hence you will like this kind of book. And that sort of helps. So the JCB Prize will actually solidify that. What about you, Deepa? How do you pick up books?
I pick up books because either friends tell me about it or I read about them.
Okay.
You know, you say, okay, my God, the book A Longlist has come out. So that's intriguing. Now I hope they'll say, the JCB Longlist has come up, you know, which is what we hope, that will intrigue people, that somebody thinks that these, of course, all writers are worthy of reading, but these were ones that one jury really liked. That's the idea, that it becomes as important as the Pulitzer, the, you know, the Booker, and it becomes our award about celebration of our people and our writers.
And it's come absolutely at the right time, because when Sharin and I started Books on Toast, which was about a year and a half ago, we also came to this realization that there was a lot of really great Indian literature being published, but readers like her and, you know, her and I, we were discovering only international literature. And we had no way to access this
contemporary
Indian fiction unless we went looking for it. So, for example, we found Ghajar Gochar because we went through a list of international reviews. And I had to go. And I just thought that was astounding, because this is the most local book there can be. This is homegrown Indian stuff. And someone who's been reading since she was a child has so much trouble finding it. So we thought that we could also use our channel as a means to then, you know, take people to these books. And that's how we're all here.
Yeah.
Good. That's great.
Deepa, I had a question for you. You know, as a filmmaker who's adapted a lot of really famous work, I mean, you've collaborated with Salman Rushdie on Midnight's Children.
And she loves Salman Rushdie, she's like crying a little inside.
Little, many tears, wonderful. And of course, I mean, there is Girish Karnad's Nagmandala, which I've seen as a play by Neela Mansingh Chaudhary like many, many years ago in Chandigarh. And then I saw it.
What are you doing in Chandigarh?
I'm from Chandigarh.
Really?
So I saw like a really nice adaptation of it to stage. I mean, there's Gik Karewale when he came to the movie as well. So as a filmmaker who is looking for stories constantly, how do you, you know, select books that you may feel have themes that are worthy of being translated to the big screen? Like, what are your expectations from Indian literary fiction?
Well, you know, I've adapted Salman's and as well as Bapsi Sidhwar's.
Yes.
And again, Nagmandala, Girish Karnad. It's not what the books say to me, actually, because that happens. It's what interests me. That's and you know, it's sort of narrow. I mean, humanitarian. I'm not interested in science fiction, you know.
Okay.
In that sense, because I think, my God, the budget will be so much. You haven't got for anything else. How do you do that? You just can't do it. I love reading science fiction, but I just can't think of as having that budget to do it. You know, Blade Runner and all. How wonderful to make a film that costs $80 million. You know, sorry, forget it. But it's really what, you know, humanity interests me, women interests me, family interests me. The fact that you can be so particular and so universal interests me. So that's, you know, Bunuel said that, I didn't, that when you're very particular, that's when you become very universal. And I think your book is like that. It's so particular, but it's totally universal. So that interests me. Maybe he'll give me the rights.
Oh, God, yes.
Oh, I can buy the rights. Yeah. Sorry, Vivek.
Vivek, that's a great segue because I want to ask you about Ghajar Gochar. So, first of all, what a superb title. And I really enjoyed discovering what it meant while I was reading the book. Yeah. And we mentioned it as one of our favorite books of 2017 when we did a video last year. And I'm sorry I'm repeating this, but I can't believe I'm sitting here with him and talking to him about it. It's amazing. So tell us a little bit about the inception of the book. How did it come about?
See, it is, I don't know, it is very difficult to say how a story is born. But some of that experience which, some of the details, not everything, but some of the details were something that, you know, I had seen 25 years ago. When I was working for an organization and I was on a sales training, so I went to a small town and I spent some time with a salesman. And the town was so small that there was no restaurant, so he took me to his house to have lunch. And I met his family and they were so much involved in his work. And since then I've been thinking about this, the relationship between, you know, work and, you know, family and so many things. And I feel that has stayed with me, and that is something that has changed in India over, you know, last 25 years after the globalization. So that is, I think that is probably was the seed, but it is very difficult to know, you know, it is from where it has come. And like there's a saying in Kannada that you must not really go finding out the root of a river, because you will be disappointed.
I think he's trying to tell you something.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a very interesting thing.
Yeah.
Guys, can I please butt in here and make a terrible joke, please? Oh, thanks. Okay. We have Kannada with us and we have Canada with us. Thank you. On that note, Deepa, can I ask you a really silly question?
About Canada? No, okay.
So, this is a question I've been wanting to ask for a while, and I can't believe that fate has given me the chance. And
I'm getting worried.
So there's a young comedian in the Bombay circuit. His name is Utsav Chakraborty, and he tweeted this tweet, and I thought it was hilarious, and I wanted to get it to you. Mm-hmm. And he said that you've made earth, and you've made fire, and you've made water. When are you going to make wind and heart, and then eventually Deepa Mehta's Captain Planet?
What? Translate, please.
Have you watched Captain Planet?
No.
Oh,
what is it?
It's a cartoon.
It's cartoon.
Uh-huh. So there are five elements. Uh-huh.
Planeteers.
Planet
there are five planets.
The earth, fire, wind, water, and heart. And together they make Captain Planet.
And he saves the world from like pollution and
climate change.
And does he wear a little cape? And
yeah, of course. And his arch nemesis is Captain Pollution.
This makes me very politically correct. Any day now. No, that's really sweet.
I think this might be the weirdest question she's been asked on an interview.
I know.
Question threw me off so much that when I was rehearsing introducing Deepa Mehta, I kept saying, the maker of wind? Not yet.
That could be completely misconstrued. Anyway.
I think it was meant to.
So, Vivek, what's next? When can we expect the next great Vivek Shanbhag novel to come out?
I don't know, it's great, but I'm working on a novel now.
Okay.
And hopefully next year.
Is it in Kannada?
I always write in Kannada.
So, is it going to be translated in English?
I think so.
Okay.
Probably.
But it's, I write for Kannada readers. So that's my, those are the people to whom I write for, primarily. And then translation takes a while.
How did Gutter Gocha get translated?
Yeah, the translator is Srinath Perur, whom I, you know for some time. And I had read his book and I had also read some of his other writings. And then I approached him for translation. Okay. And then it took us about, end to end, it took us about a year and a half for this book. So the translation is always a very intense process, especially, you know, because there are so many iterations on to get it right.
Yes.
And especially to get the tone right.
Yes.
So it is, it's not easy. So it's sometimes, you know, it may be even more difficult than writing a book. But it's important that we have, we focus on translations. When I say we, I mean in India, because there are really a lot of good books written in Indian languages.
Yes.
And we have a, we don't have good translators. And it is important that those books are translated and well translated, not just translated.
Mm-hmm.
Because what happens is you have a great book, but in a bad translation, the book is lost. That culture, I hope, will also get nurtured to some extent with the JCB Prize. Because this prize considers translations, and it may, you know, enthuse some translators to, you know, take it up seriously.
Mm-hmm. One of the challenges with translations is not just the fact that, you know, it's literal, it's also geographical, right? Because a lot of the subject matter, like you said, you only write for Kannada, you know, readers.
Yeah.
So the fact that a lot of the topography will not be familiar to people, say, who are growing up in North, because they are not very familiar with the socio-political scenarios. So how important is that from an author's perspective to ensure that that doesn't get lost in the translation?
See, we read a book because it is something that we don't know. I don't want to read something which I already know, right? So if somebody, if I want to read a book which is from Assam, I really want to know those details. So, you know, not because they are, you know, normalized and they are conveyed to me in the language that I know of. Like today we, even today we read Tolstoy and appreciate, written some 150 years ago. And none of those details we can't, you know, we can't even visualize many of the details, right? But still we read and enjoy because there is something which is at the core of it, which is, you know, certain human situations. Certain, you know, certain insight into life. So those things are very important. So in translation, it is important that we are accurate. At the same time, it is something that is that happens in the target language. It has to be born in that language because every language has a you know swabhava. It has a character, and that swabhava is something which expresses itself in its structure, in its metaphors, in its. So it is important for the translator to understand it, and it's a translation is a very creative process.
Also, translation in other languages, not just from, you know, say Kannada to an English, but also from an English to a Punjabi. One of the issues that we've also discussed about a lot when we tried to do an episode on translated literature was the fact that access and representation of your own community and state to people who are otherwise not native to that mother tongue is so difficult because they keep asking, ke, "Arey, but what does this mean?" You know, for instance, like Amrita Pritam is like somebody whose work is so well renowned, but her translations were so difficult to access until and unless Kushwant Singh translated because, you know, his sensibilities are same. So she got her insight. But if I were to, you know, find a translation of that same thing in Marathi, it would be very difficult to do. So do you think that also requires some amount of work to do?
See, translation amongst, between Indian languages must happen more. And I think we should avoid doing translations into Indian languages through English. Recently, there is a reason for it. Because even the grammatical structure, the verb is at the end of the sentence in most of the Indian languages, right?
Correct.
So when you read a sentence, a writer works a lot on this because when you read a sentence, you until your eye meets the verb, you don't know what is the meaning of the sentence.
Correct.
Like, you know, it is like I, you, love. Mm-hmm. When I say I and you, unless, you don't know whether I say hate or love, right? So it is the verb is in the end in Indian languages, while in English it's the other way. So you lose it. In the first place itself, because, you know, as I said, the sentences are constructed in such a manner that you go through the whole description and at the end, it explodes, the meaning is exploded in your mind. And when you translate it, that all goes for a toss. So that impact that the writer has created, for example, when I do that in Kannada, it's not the same when it happens in English. But you can preserve this if you translate directly between Indian languages, because the Indian language structure is the same. So between Punjabi and Marathi, if you do direct translation, it will be much more powerful and meaningful than if you go through English. So for example, recently my book Ghachar Gochar was translated into Bangla based on a Hindi version and not English. Because there were no, and Arunava Sinha did it, and there was no direct translation translators available between Kannada and Bangla. So I suggested that we go through Hindi. Because at least, you know, that's preserved. You know, why go through English when there is a Hindi translation available?
That's interesting to know.
We never thought of it that way.
And I suggest we use the word Indian language and not vernacular, because vernacular has a derogatory meaning.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Deepa, what about you? Do you have a book in you? A fiction?
Me, yaar.
A big tome.
इनकी पढ़ेंगे
हम पिक्चर बनाएंगे
बैठ के पिक्चर बनाएंगे ये लिखें
गाइस अडैप्टेशन हैज बिकम क्वाइट द बज़वर्ड दीस डेज लाइक समथिंग लाइक दिस हैपनिंग राइट नाउ इज एक्चुअली सुपर्ब फॉर द राइटिंग कम्युनिटी बिकॉज विद द कमिंग ऑफ लाइक अ नेटफ्लिक्स और अमेज़न प्राइम the kind of content that is being converted isn't limited anymore. People are creating different content for different sensibilities. I know that Deepa, you've already said you'd love to adapt Ghachar Gochar, but Vivek, when you were writing it or once it came out, did you consider watching it as a TV show? Or I think it would make a fantastic TV show, but I need to shut up about it now. I need to shut up. Any...
Yes, you have to, because we are in negotiation already. Yeah.
No, I don't think at the time of writing any of these things come to my mind.
Okay.
And it shouldn't be also, because what I'm trying to do is through a medium, which is language. Right? And when I write something, it is intended to create certain memories, evoke certain memories in you when you read something. And visually, it is different. I'm sure, Deepa, when you work in this medium, you have a different way of evoking memories and connecting with people.
Totally.
So I don't want to really get mixed up with these two. Because I want to just do my job. Yeah. Do, you know, which I'm good at. So I'll only stick to that.
What about the long-listed authors? Are you hoping that some of those get picked up and get told on the big screen, Deepa?
I think, I don't know. I mean, I think it depends on the authors, right? If they want it, they have to think about, you know, that the fact that medium, one medium is going to be translated in the other. And it's worked well for some books in the past. And I think it does depend on the writers after they've written their book and that's what they wanted to write. If they want to take it and see it interpreted into a film or a television series or a Netflix series or whatever, then that's up to them. I mean, I think that what's good about that is that it gives an extended life to the novel. I mean, I saw for the first time, I think just last week, that the book Sacred Games was all over the airport. So it's nice that it's been resurrected in that sense.
Awesome. I just want to thank both of you for coming here, listening to us and answering our questions so patiently. Because seriously, we are not worthy. But thank you. All of you guys, thank you for watching. If you like this video, then please share it. Leave comments, talk about more books, talk about all the books that have been discussed in today's episode, and especially the great long list that JCB and this esteemed panel has put together for you to read. Participate in the reading challenge. Remember, it's hashtag JCB Reading Challenge. That's not so hard. You're like, Anuya, hum kaise padhenge? JCB hota hai, padh lo.
Also, do note all the books that we discussed. The links will be in the description box below for you guys to pick it up so that your number of clicks are lesser. So you don't ask us where to buy. They're literally there.
And we are also on Patreon. So if you like Books on Toast, you can support our work. Go to patreon.com/books on toast.
And what happens at patrons.com?
It's a site that allows you to pay a monthly subscription fee for the content that you like. So a lot of YouTubers internationally actually get by through Patreon because fan support, it's like crowdsourcing. But
okay.
Thank you for watching and remember to keep reading because it makes you smart.